I anticipate that China's security markets and investing practices will get better and better for a long, long time. I think there's more value for the investor in the, you buy the best companies in China or the best companies in the United States. I think that at current prices, the best companies in China are selling cheaper.
芒格, 为什么喜欢中国人并欣赏孔子? 儒家思想对于投资来说, 为什么会起到正向的推动作用?
If you're a better person, you're likely to be a better investor. And if you're a wiser person, you're likely to be a better investor.
为什么芒格与巴菲特这些价值投资大师能够长寿? 一个人怎样生活才是更有意义?
Well, they live it one day at a time. And you do the best you can every day, and pretty soon you've had a good life.
Peter说：“这个人用思想的力量拓展了我的视野，让我以异乎寻常的速度从大猩猩变成了人类，否则我会比现在贫穷得多。”这个人就是今年95岁的查理芒格，当今最伟大的投资思想家。许多读过《穷查理宝典》的人都曾感慨芒格智慧的醍醐灌顶。今年5月份，洪州勘团队远赴奥马哈。 对伯克希尔股东大会进行了全程报道，并于美国时间5月6日下午对查理芒格以及外界盛传的查理芒格的衣钵传人、美国喜马拉雅基金创始人及董事长李路先生做了长达2个小时的深度专访。整个采访过程中，我们聊到了十几个话题，对于国内职业投资人的困惑，芒格先生也一一作答。 芒格先生完全不像个95岁的老人，他精神矍铄，声音浑厚，语言风趣幽默，点评一针见血。接下来就请跟随洪周刊一起近距离走进查理芒格。特别感谢芒格先生跟李路先生能在百忙之中接受我们证券市场洪周刊的采访。这次采访不仅是我们洪周刊之幸，也是国内职业投资人之幸。您的 穷查理宝典，这本书在国内职业投资人里影响力非常大。芒格先生和李路先生，因为您一直是价值投资的思想大师，也一直在践行，您的投资理念其实在国内影响了一大批职业投资人，但是其实国内对价值投资还真的存在很多很多误区。我们希望这次采访能带回去一些东西，就能够给国内职业投资人做一些传道授业。 解惑，然后让他们在价值投资的正路上能够越走越宽，越走越远。
I said, we'll help as much as we can. You ask questions, we'll answer.
芒格先生一直强调，投资要耐得住时间，要找到好的标的，并且要长期坚持。在中国的文化里，也一直强调做事专一，直到完成。可在这样的文化里，却有一个奇怪的现象。 在资本市场里，很多人在投机不专一。那我们就先从第一部分开始，就是职业投资人如何树立正确的投资理念。芒格先生，您一直强调哈，包括在这次的伯克希尔股东大会上，您就说投资要找到好的机会，并且去长期坚持，耐得住时间。用我们中国话讲的话，就是十年磨一剑。但是其实很多职业投资人他知道这个道理，但是却耐不住时间。 的寂寞最终投资无果，那么怎么才能做到知行合一？
Yes, well, if you invest the way people gamble in casinos, you're not going to do very well. So, it's the long-term investment that works best, and But if you like the action of investing, sometimes winning, sometimes losing, just like people like the action when they gamble in a casino, those people are not my people. I like the long-term investors who figure out something that's going to work over the long term and buy that. And the sooner the Chinese people gamble less and invest patiently for the long term more, the sooner they will do better.
那么芒格先生也提到过，投资是需要耐心。那么耐心的话，就您说的这个东西是天生的、天性的东西。有的人他本身就适合投资，那是不是说我没有这个东西的话，我就做不了投资
？The world is full of foolish gamblers, and they will not do as well as the patient investors. Well, I think it can be learned to some extent, and to some extent you're born with it. There's a saying.In America, they call a long attention span. They can keep their mind on a game or an activity for a long time until they've solved it. And the Chinese do have a long attention span. And that is a hugely desirable quality because you're more likely to get the right answer if you think deeply and hard about a subject for a long time. And it's odd that a group of people who are so good at having a long attention span.Like to gamble so much, which is quite counterproductive.
那么芒格先生，您也说过投资不容易，因为我们在这个市场上看到的多数都是假象。那么怎样理解投资人看到的都是假象？那么真相又在哪儿？我们怎么能够获取真相
？A lot of people think there is such a thing as truth in the markets. That the market is going to tell you something just by bouncing around.That is not the way Berkshire Hathaway or Charlie Munger invests money. We have a view as to what the intrinsic value is of what is being traded, and we only buy it when we think it's worth more than we're paying. So we're trying to make a long-term investment by waiting for something to be underpriced and then buying it. And we don't give a damn about all these gamblers in the market.To me, they're just so much froth, and it's a foolish way to spend your time if you want to get rich.
他在讲的这个什么是真相，就是这个公司本身的真实的价值，天然的价值。所以理解了这一点，才能够真正的去赚钱。那些仅仅去关心这个价格的波动，这个用这个来指导他们投资的人，这个用这种方法赚钱，实际上是蛮愚蠢的一个活动。
其实价格表现出来很多就是假象，说的
是这样的。
只有30年历史的中国资本市场，需要什么条件，多长时间才能培育出像芒格、巴菲特这样的投资大师呢？芒格先生认为，你不需要投资很多东西才会变得富有。今年95岁的查理·芒格只投资了3个公司。这3个公司分别是什么呢？
在中国哈，确实很多职业投资人以芒格先生、巴菲特先生还有李路先生都为偶像。那么就是想请芒格先生哈，结合美国的市场谈一谈，现在只有30年历史的这个中国的资本市场，需要一个什么条件，多长时间才能培育出像您3位这样的大师
？Well, the Chinese market.Is going to create a lot of successful investors. If you look at Hong Kong, which has been full of Chinese people enmeshed in a capitalist order with a good securities market, that is going to spread all over China and increase in respectability and size for decades ahead.I anticipate that China's security markets and investing practices will get better and better for a long, long time. There'll be fluctuations, to be sure, but the long-term trend will be toward more achievement, more respectability, and higher prices.
他并没有说回答直接回答你的问题的意思，就是说他在这里面一定会出现其他的大师。
那其实还是跟这资本市场的历史有关系。
它就会慢慢的去发展，越来越好。
The Chinese who've gotten rich in Hong Kong over the last 50 years are not the short-term traders and the gamblers. It has been the long-term investors who sought out good long-term investments and stubbornly held them for long periods of time. And just as that worked for the Chinese in Hong Kong, it'll work for the Chinese on the mainland. It's not the short-term gambling that's good. It's the identifying the good long-term investment and sticking with it for a long time.
那么，香港的例子也在也可以很好的印证中国将来的情况。真正能够赚到大钱的，一定是长期的投资人，不是短期的交易员。
嗯，
赌博性质的交易员。
嗯嗯，那请问芒格先生，这一生中哈最满意的投资和最不满意的一笔投资是什么？
My Berkshire Hathaway stock cost me $16 a share, and it's now selling for almost $300,000 a share. That's been a very good investment. It took a long time, and it was a long-term investment where I liked the people I was investing with, and I liked the companies I was investing in, and I just sat there for more than 50 years, and lo and behold, it's worked out very well. And there are lots of stories like that. And Lulu and I have been investing together in China for what, 13 years or so?
Yeah, 15 years.
15 years. And we have bought a lot of securities and we've sold very few. I have not made very many bad investments. They've been small and not very many. I don't have many bad investments. Neither does Lulu. Basically, the Mungers have three stocks, so to speak. We've got Berkshire, we've got Costco, and we have an investment in Lulu's partnership. Three things. I'm well along in my 95th year. Three things. You don't need to own a lot of different things to get rich.
Yeah.
中国的价值投资者非常喜欢芒格和巴菲特。芒格说，他和沃伦的行为很像深度信奉儒家思想的人。芒格和巴菲特也真的非常喜欢中国人。那么，这两个远在奥马哈的智慧老人为什么会这么喜欢中国人呢？
芒格先生正好谈到了这个中国市场，那我接下来的问题就是问李先生跟芒格先生一起的哈。其实这次股东大会我们可以看到，其中有10,000人是来自中国的。那些问题的话，中国其实也是一个焦点。然后我记得当时芒格先生回答的时候说，那个，您提到了中国的未来是很光明的，而且已经在中国寻找猎物。刚才您跟芒格先生都说了，那其实我们特别特别感兴趣哈，就中国现在处于一个什么样的投资时节，是不是像芒格先生那时候说的，1973年或者是1974年，甚至是1982年吧，就是让猪罗都可以流口水的那个时候，中国是不是处于这个？然后，中国的猎物你们瞄向什么方向
？I know it's very peculiar. It's very peculiar. It is very peculiar, and they asked me, the New York Times just interviewed, and they asked me, why are these people in China so interested in Berkshire Hathaway and Charlie Munger? Partly the book did it, but why do the Chinese like that book? I think the answer is that it sounds Confucian. China has a deep Confucian ethos. They want people to act modestly, even though they're rich and powerful. They want people to constantly keep learning and to behave with dignity and reason and improve as they get old and keep working. Well, those lessons are not confined to one country. But it just happens that Warren Buffett and I act like a bunch of people that take Confucianism very seriously. That's why they like us.
芒格先生现在一年读几本书，大概方向是什么？
Oh, people, they know I like books. So people give me so many books that I either skim or read through 20 books a week. No, I get lots of books. I read a lot of biography and some history. I read almost no fiction. You said, he asked me what other reason for the reason that we're suddenly popular in China.
Yeah.
And I said, there's one more reason, is that Warren and I really like the Chinese. And of course, everybody likes people who like them.
Oh, yeah.
So that's what happens. Now you say, why have the Chinese gotten so popular with a couple of Omaha boys? That's something that a lot of Chinese don't understand. If you look at China with the viewpoint of a United States citizen, here is what you see. When the Chinese first came in here, we were trying to build the Transcontinental Railroad in the winter through horrible passes in the steep mountains. And nobody could do it. It was impossible. People were dying and it was just too hard. So they brought in like 50,000 Chinese coolies who were in those days practically slaves. And they took those coolies up into the mountains in the winter and they said, you build a railroad. And they did. And the Americans couldn't do it by themselves. Well, that of course made a very favorable impression. Well, fade in, fade out. And now we've had all this immigration of Asians, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Vietnamese, so on. And what have those Asians done in America? Well, they've come in and rapidly become doctors, lawyers, professors, businessmen, and so forth, and succeeded mightily. And if we go to our symphony orchestra, which didn't used to have any Chinese in it, every instrument that's hard to play and takes unlimited practice, you look up from the instrument, there's a Chinese face. Well, of course, we find people popular who are succeeding so much in our country, and they're not causing a lot of trouble. They're just succeeding. And so naturally we like the Chinese. And I don't think the ordinary person on mainland China understands what an image of success China has in the United States, because the Chinese Americans have done so well here. And the most extreme thing of all that nobody could have anticipated, nobody ever talks about it, and you should talk about it in your magazine, is because there was so much poverty in China and it was so overpopulated, if an American couple were unable to have children of their own, they could always go to China and adopt a Chinese girl from a very poor family. So in every important city of America, people soon learned they got better babies taking the unwanted Chinese girls from the remote Chinese farms. That those babies, on average, worked out better than if they had their own children. And so everybody wanted to adopt a child. They don't want an American child. They want a Chinese girl. And of course, all those girls worked out well. And most people in China don't realize how extreme that's been. That's happened in every American city. Every American private school is full of the discarded Chinese girls from the Chinese countryside, and they're getting all A's and winning the prizes. And of course, it makes a favorable impression. And you should write about it, because every city is full of these adopted Chinese girls being raised by American families, and they're spectacularly successful, even though they come from a background of poverty. So it's just dramatic, and it's all over America. You go to northern Minnesota, there are these Chinese girls. And they're playing the difficult instruments in the orchestra.
所以你把这些东西都在加在一起的，你会感觉到我们其实在奥马哈，我们两个一辈子都是出生长大的，那也对中国有一个非常强烈的好的印象，尤其是最后一点，可能在生活在大陆的人可能不太能够去理解，所以从这个角度去看中国的印象，这就是我们为什么一直非常喜欢中国，喜欢中国的文化。
So they also want to know the second part of the question is that from your perspective, where is Chinese security market today? It is like the 73, 74, 82. Where is it now? How do you really see the current stage of the security market? They wanted both of us to answer, so you'll go first.
All right. I think there's more value for the investor in the, if you buy the best companies in China or the best companies in the United States, I think that at current prices, the best companies in China are selling cheaper than the best companies in the United States. So I think it's, the Chinese don't have to go abroad to find good investments. They've got plenty right in their own country. There's some awfully strong companies in China that are selling at reasonable prices.
中国现在正处在一个转型期啊，我们经历了大概40年高速增长之后呢，整个中国经济进入到一个新兴的转折时代。那在这个转折时代，通常呢会有很多各种各样的这个anxiety 啊，大家都会有一些心理上的这个不安、焦虑，所以造成对前途看得不是太清楚啊。但是实际上我觉得这个转型呢，对中国的前途应该是更好的。经济本身呢，它从这个传统的出口制造开始慢慢的进入到更多的服务消费。技术上呢也开始不断的在越来越这个科技含量越来越高。从这个整个金融市场上呢已经开始慢慢的从这个传统的以债务为主的这个融资方式变成主要以直接融资以股权为主。这个也是我们去杠杆必须要走的一条路。所以整个这个股权融资呢一定会将来整个中国金融结构呢扮演越来越重要的角色。那在这个过程里面呢市场的主体呢也逐渐的在发生变化。我们传统上这个主要是以零售市场是以个人投资者为主。那么从现在开始往后呢我们看得很清楚呢机构投资者尤其是长期的比较有耐心的这些资金慢慢的开始进入到市场。国外的长期的更有经验的职业投资也开始慢慢到进入到这个市场。所以这个市场主体会发生变化。那么这个变化在美国呢是在70年代后期发生的。其实在70年代中期以前美国市场其实也是以零售以个人投资为主的一个市场。这个也是这个 trading 啊刚才 Charlie 讲到的这些赌博性质的这种交易呢其实也是广泛的存在的。那么到了70年代后最重要的这个变化是什么呢就是养老金开始变成了一个mandate 就是必须得有的。就每一个公司每一个个人都要求必须要有强制性的储蓄。那么强制储蓄这个政策呢就使得机构投资整个机构投资开始崛起。整个市场主体慢慢的在下面的这个十几二十年里面慢慢发生了根本性的变化。那么今天这个整个市场主体是完完全全以机构投资为主。那机构投资当然也不是大家都是这个长期这个 patient， 但是比相对于个人投资来说，确确实实有发生一个质的变化。那在这个里面呢，这个价值投资理念也慢慢的被更多的人的接受。所以我觉得这个所有的事情都是一个长期一个过程。如果有这个时间眼光放得远一点，这个放得耐心一些，你就会看到呢，这样一个时期其实是给这个优秀的有这个耐心的长期投资人提供一些蛮好的机会。
这个资本市场开放的速度也越来越快，你看刚才像芒格先生，包括李路先生，我也知道在中国都有一些投资。那么在这个过程中，中国资本市场需要再做一些什么改革来去突破瓶颈，能让这个外资的投资更顺畅，更好地保护国内国外的这个股东的利益？
Well,China is opening up more and more to foreign investors, and its markets are getting stronger and stronger with more participation from the world outside of China. That's all to the good. And eventually, it'll drive some prices up in China.
这个六月份呢是整个这个外资进入的一个开始哈。过去的几年呢，中国政府呢有几项非常重要的举措，这个使得外国投资在尤其是中国的 A 股国内的市场变得非常的便利啊。首先呢，这个港沪通、港深通，
对，
那么现在要深轮通，
对，
这些呢是这个让外资进入中国大概最最重要的这个举措。那么当然我们看到的这 MSCI 的这个加入呢，其实也是对这一个这个改革的一个直接反应。另外从今年开始呢，这个另外一项我觉得具有蛮深远的影响的这个改革呢，就是这个外资尤其是金融服务行业，包括金融投资行业、金融这个资产管理行业，在中国的这个管理股权放开啊，这个市场逐渐的放开，这个又是一项非常非常我觉得会有蛮长影响的这样一个改革的举措，这些都非常的好。我觉得就你的问题呢，就是说还有哪些事情可以做能够让这个市场进一步，我觉得如果在这个监管方面呢，这个它的监管举措呢和这个和国外的能够也有类似的连接啊，就是说我们有一些共同遵守的，比如说关于 accounting 的这些管理方法，能够和主要的市场，比如说香港，比如说纽约，比方说伦敦，能够有一些互相的这个连在的哈，共同的这个措施，尤其是关于比如说退市等等啊，这个就变得非常对。那么就是说在这个我觉得这个金融领域内的反腐做得非常的好啊。首先呢，要把这个市场真正的清理开，清理开以后呢，那个好的进来，这个坏的出去，慢慢的能够让这个注册制逐渐的，哪怕是中国特色的注册制，能够逐渐的这个落地啊，
真正形成退市驱逐劣币，
对，变成良币驱逐劣币，优秀的公司能够被引入到或者请回到这个国内的市场，然后让更多的机构投资者，无论是国内还是国外的机构投资者，慢慢变成投资的主体，那么中国就会在下面几十年里面进入一个良性的循环，那么股权投资就会作为中国整个金融活动里面最重要的方式，那么慢慢依赖银行、依赖间接投资的方式呢也会改变，那么中国呢也会去把这个去杠杆啊真正去掉了一个这个对于中国经济长期增长一个重要的隐患，把整个杠杆降下来，这样的话就进入一个长期比较良性的过程。所以我觉得下面这些改革呢，对中国不仅证券市场，而且整个经济体制的改革呢，都是具有非常深远的影响。
一直以工业品和消费品为投资标的的伯克希尔，为什么会选择苹果这样的科技股呢？除了苹果，伯克希尔还会投资其他科技股吗？
是我们一直都知道，伯克希尔在投资股票的时候，都是以消费品和这个工业品为主。然后从2011年开始投资 IBM， 到现在成为苹果的第二大股东。我们知道，就是在一季度的时候，伯克希尔还增持了苹果是7500万股吧。那么在这个过程中的话，就是这种投资的转变是新的能力圈的一个拓展吗？
Well, Berkshire has had great difficulty finding investments in the American markets that were low priced enough so we thought that they were very good investments. And finally, we found a few, and so they're a little different. After all,You can argue that Apple is a consumer electronics company. And Warren said he could understand consumer electronics better than he can understand computer science. And so that explains the Apple performance. And besides, there's another reason why we're doing it. You have to keep learning if you want to be a good investor. And so...As we've kept learning and as conditions have changed, our investments have changed.
这些新的投资也是这个巴菲特、芒格先生学习的结果。那其实就是比如说像亚马逊、苹果、Facebook，还有谷歌什么的，这些很多中国的投资人他在做国际配置的时候，他也会有。那伯克希尔未来会更多的去关注更多的科技股吗？
Well, the only thing we've announced we've invested in is Apple. And I think that what Warren said was he understands Apple better than those other companies. We don't know everything. And so we invest in whatever we can find with our abilities that seems to us to offer good value. And of course, that sometimes causes an odd mix. Look at the airline investment. We have joked for decades about airline investment as being terrible for the shareholders who make airline investments. And all of a sudden, we buy stock in practically every airline. The stock had just pounded down. They were so cheap and so powerful. And the conditions had changed a little, and we were willing to own some airline stocks. We changed. We changed because the world changed.
这就是我们投资的基本逻辑，世界发生变化，我们也会跟着变化。我们必须要不断的去学习。所以这样的这个变化的结果，可能在很多人看来，我们的这个portfolio 看起来显得比较奇怪，但这就是结果。Warren
and I hated railroad stocks for decades. But the world changed, and pretty soon we got down to only four big railroads, and technology changed. The shipping to the Orient got important. The whole world changed. And then we bought railroad stock, and then we bought a whole railroad. We changed our mind because the facts changed. Don't you change your minds when the facts change?
过去50年。 美国的资本市场给投资者带来超额收益的，都是和生活息息相关的股票。最近10年，科技股才开始发力。那么，中国的资本市场会复制美国这条路吗？给美国投资者带来超额收益的都是吃喝拉撒的这种消费类的股票。然后就是最近10年才有像亚马逊啊、谷歌呀这种科技类的股票。然后就是开始发力。那么就是说，中国的资本市场。 会不会也会复制美国这条路？就是比如说，您可以预计一下未来10年或者20年这种大的前景跟格局是什么？
It's already happened. It's already happened. Yeah, it's already happened in China. Same thing has happened in China.
就是在这个经济整个在这个发展过程中，我觉得我们大概可能。 还是在这个，就是我在我的这个现代化实例讲里面谈到，我说我们这个是在这个2.5的这个过程啊，就是它确确实实是在一个这个发展中国家的晚期，发达国家的早期这样一个过程啊。在这个过程里面呢，就是这个消费服务会变得非常非常的重要。那么消费服务呢？ 是一个确实是一个很好的领域，能够产生非常优秀的、长期，这个能够保持竞争优势的公司。同时呢，我们这个在互联网时代，中国确确实实几乎是跟全球是同步的。那么在某些方面呢，比如说无论是腾讯还是阿里呢，有很多自己独特的这个独特的创造。 那么在这个和他们相比的这个美国公司呢，也其实在某些方面不如做他们，各有千秋，可以这么说啊。还有一些，比如说这个像我们因为突破了这个 payment 这个支付的这个瓶颈，比如说很多东西像这个共享啊，这些没有支付简易的支付是很难做起来，所以这方面应该说这个中国走到前面。 还有一些其他的方面，比如说像这个今日头条啊等等，其实在很多方面，其实在类似的公司里面，其实是走在美国的这个前列啊。当然有一些它独特的原因，并不是我不会去一一的去谈了。所以我就说，这个整个市场经济是一个非常奇妙的东西。当这个经济发展到一定程度的时候，它就会自己自动创造出那些最。 优秀的伟大的公司啊。那么很多在美国经历过的事情，在中国确实就像芒格先生说的呢，确实是有可能会这个重复，但也不会是简单重复。所以投资呢，这个简单但是也没有那么简单，还是需要艰苦的努力去学习，慢慢的去找到自己适合的。所以找到这些公司呢，我觉得最重要的还是要承认自己的这个能力的边界。比如说你问我的这些问题，其实我不是能够去所有东西都能够回答，我有一个大体的感觉，但是每一间公司必须要具体的公司具体的分析。我们也不会去做那些比较大的这个完整的这个预测，这些不是我们的投资风格。这些对于真正投资的收益其实一点用也没有，反常常是帮倒忙啊，会让你这个进入到先入为主的这样一个状态，其实对投资的收益一点都不好。所以我觉得还是要脚踏实地，这个一间公司一间公司具体的公司具体分析。但是从大势上讲，我们确实是看到美国已经发生的事情在中国也会被重复。那么这个互联网科技呢，也确实会产生它自己独特的这些这些优秀的公司。
那像腾讯您有关注吗？
所有这些优秀公司我们都会关注。但是我们并不由我们就是无论是 Berkshire 先生、Munger 先生、Buffett 先生，我们基本上从来不讨论我们这个具体的投资。比较抱歉啊。
一周读20本书的查理芒格认为，人的一生怎么过才会有意义呢？为什么价值投资大师会长寿？
您回答的真的已经非常精彩了。那咱们进入这个话题哈。
好。
这个我是单独问芒格先生的，是关于这个一些人性和投资方面的。您的这个《穷查理宝典》里提到了哈，就是说特别崇尚孔子的这个孝道。那么就是说还有很多儒家思想，就是跟这个《穷查理宝典》是相通的。那么这个东西，您觉得这儒家思想对于投资来说的话？能够对投资起到一个什么正向的推动作用？
Well, if you're a better person, you're likely to be a better investor. And if you're a wiser person, you're likely to be a better investor. What's not to like in Confucianism? Now, he was speaking a long time ago, 2,500 years. It's a long time ago. The world has found out a lot of things Confucius didn't know. But his basic attitude,pretty damn civilized.
那么作为就是有情感有思想的这个存在哈，就作为我们人，您觉得就是怎样生活才更有意义？
Well, they live it one day at a time, and you do the best you can every day, and pretty soon you've had a good life. It's too hard, you know, when people want to get over alcoholism, they just think, I'm going to get through one more day without drinking.And if you want to be a good person, I'm going to get one more day being a better person. You do that for enough days, and pretty soon you're a better person. It's pretty simple.
那么就还有一个问题啊，就是在投资领域哈，做价值投资的哈，就都长寿。这个美国的历史可以印证哈，就像您还有巴菲特先生啊，就是都在90岁以上。巴菲特先生今年88岁哈。那么这个东西是偶然的。
Sure, it's one of your favorite questions.
Well, if you analyze who lives a long life, professors, judges, value investors, who lives a short life, journalists, hard drinkers, hard smokers, it's not very hard.Know what to avoid.
是他的回答。Well, you're talking to a journalist, Charlie.
I know, but in America, the journalists tended to smoke a lot and drink a lot and have a lot of deadlines, so always under stress, and they died young. And the judge just sits there. The courtroom goes at his pace, not somebody else's.There's nobody over him telling him to do something. The judge lives forever. And the trial lawyers, they die young too. Yeah, a lot of stress, a lot of problems.
Really kind of,
what?
Well, the traders have to really...
And traders are the worst of all. The short-term stock traders die the quickest. They drink and they smoke and they, they're tortured by.
You describe perfectly the life of the journalist.
Great and nice.
Yeah.
but she doesn't drink, she doesn't smoke. So you live long.
College professors live forever.
Yeah.
Well, Warren and I don't meet so much anymore. We talk on the phone. We don't talk as much as we used to. But the one thing's the same. 30 people in Berkshire headquarters. Berkshire added $65 billion to its net worth last year. Guess how many people it added to headquarters? Zero. That's an interesting company. Zero.
所以我们这个之所以能够这么长呢，就是因为我们没有任何官僚体系，没有任何中间各种各样的layer，有事情我们就聊，没事就不聊，我们需要就加，不需要就不加，这个公司本身这个没有这些一样的，我们去年增加了650亿美金的这个净值。杭哥先生曾经说过，对于一个职业投资人来说，最重要的一个词是理性。 而不是知识、努力和耐心。芒格先生，接下来我跟您交流的问题是国内职业投资人痞子泰基金董宝珍先生跟您交流的问题，很遗憾没能亲自到现场跟您进行对话。
He's the guy who gives you 15-year multi.
Yeah. Tell him.
I only gave you 5-year.
Anybody who gives me 15-year multi is my kind of a man. If he has any question, I'll be pleased to answer any question he has. And I'm asking Lulu, why is he such a cheap bastard?
Number one，就是您曾说过哈，一个投资人最重要的一个词就是理性。那么就是说，在您看来，理性是最重要的，为什么不首先是知识、智力或者是耐心？
Well, all those things are important, but I would argue that rationality, which is seeing the world the way it is instead of the way you hope it is, I'd say that's the most important. If you don't see the world the way it is, it's like judging something through a distorted lens. You think the world is one way and it's different. And of course, that leads to terrible mistakes. You want to think correctly.
看世界就是什么样就是什么样，也就是中国人讲的叫实事求是，而不是只看到你希望看到的东西。那么实际情况是哈，可是我们人大部分时候都是处在非理性的状态。是这样。是吧？那我们靠什么来慢慢的说从非理性到理性？什么能让我们能够保持理性呢？
Well, you got to work at it, and you got to care about it. If you don't care whether you're rational or not, and you don't work on it, then you can just stay as irrational as you want all your life and take the lousy results you're sure to get.
还是得自己从本身，我就想把自己变成一个理性的人，那么我才会去探索如何成为理性的人，在这里去寻找知识，慢慢的。对，你要如果不希望理性的话，你只能接受人生比较痛苦的结果。
I carry it further, and it's basically a Confucian attitude. I think you have a moral duty to become as rational as you can.
那比如说，我想成为一个理性的人。
那么我怎么才能慢慢的一点一点突破和进步呢？假如说我想，我就想把自己变成一个理想。
You work at it all your life, and you read a lot.
伯克希尔在谈到接班人的时候哈，提了三个条件，一个是独立思考。一个是情绪稳定，然后还有一个就是对人性和机构行为特点的敏锐的洞察。其实我们可以看到这三个问题里，他提的都是人性博弈，是情绪博弈，而不是说对企业的基本面或者是估值的一个判断。那么就是说，首先在做投资上控制的是这个情绪，就是理性方面的事情是。
Well, let me take it.Human nature in a big bureaucracy makes bad decisions. And so if you don't know that human nature in a big bureaucracy is going to make bad decisions, you may give more respect to those decisions than they deserve. So it helps to understand where human nature is automatically causing bad results so you can avoid them. Well, anything that enables you to predict and adjust to reality. The reality is, if you're dealing with a big, dumb bureaucracy, it's very difficult and unpleasant. And the sooner you learn that and how to handle it, the better off you are.
So his 核心，他的所有的理性，这个观点呢，实际上都是这个理解这个世界本来是什么呀，就把它理解成什么呀，而不是去理解那些你想要看到的事情。
还是回到刚才咱们聊的那个问题。
理性是最重要的。
那么就是说，用理性去战胜人固有的这种动物的这种本性，是投资的本质吗？
这是也不能说是本质，这是一个很重要的工作，这是很重要的方面。
就是它优先于对一个公司基本面的研究。
是的。所以说，就是刚才芒格先生讲的，就是这个理性的态度，比这个知识、比技能、比这个耐心都还真的重要一些。是最重要的。
那接下来这个问题可能。
So I answered a couple questions for you because I know exactly how you think.
Good, good, good.
在《穷查理宝典》中。芒格先生给出了25种人类误判心理学模型。在接受《红周刊》采访时，芒格先生用自己的实例说明，不去思考这些问题，后果有多严重。当年的误判，加上机会成本，让他损失了近50亿美金。
就是芒格先生的这个《穷查理宝典》一直在强调学科交叉的这个重要性，而且也提到了就是最重要的心理学，然后就是他提到的25种人类误判心理学模型，其实对国内职业投资人是非常有影响的。看完了之后，就很多人有感触。然后这里边哈，就是有一个重要的问题，就是他提到了，就是人心理失衡的时候会一塌糊涂，心平气和的时候就会顺利前行。那就是这个心态哈，就决定了就是投资人的命运。那么就是可不可以说，资本市场的财富表面上看是企业创造的？本质上是我们的心灵创造了财富。如果是资本市场的财富是心灵创造的，应该拥有什么样的心灵特质，并怎么样去获取这样的心灵特质
？Those are just out of the introductory course in psychology in every university. People don't learn. They teach it in the university, and nobody pays any attention. Let's take a simple question. As I said in that book.They offered me 300 shares of Belridge Oil, which I bought because I had the money on hand. Then they offered 1,500 more at the same price. And now I had to sell something or borrow the money. And so I bought the 300 and not the 1,500. Well, that decision has cost me now about $5 billion. I'd be $5 billion richer if I'd bought the other 1,500. It's the contrast. It didn't inconvenience me in any way to buy the 300, and it inconvenienced me. And just the extra contrast made my judgment go sour. And it was the dumbest goddamn decision, one of the dumbest investment decisions I ever made in my whole life. And it was, just came from a simple, the stock was not overpriced because it was a little more inconvenient for me to buy it. But the inconvenience was enough to trigger my mind. And there was another problem on that. It was even worse. The man who dominated that corporation was eccentric and heavy drinking.
Yeah.
And but the oil field wasn't drinking.
That's right.
And, yeah. Anyway, so I had two different psychological reasons why I made the wrong decision. I thought too much about how much the man was drinking, yeah, and too little about how good the oil field was. And then I thought too much about my own inconvenience and too little about the basic situation. So I screwed up fairly well. But that should encourage you people.
Yeah.
You can blow them, one of your, the major opportunities of your life, and still muddle through all right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Think of the people who have an utterly miserable first marriage and a wonderful second marriage.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just all kinds of things get fixed.
你要去想去 avoid呢, 要真的是要很认真地去学习这个才能够不断地去变得更加理性。芒格和巴菲特先生一直非常厌恶杠杆，但在此次接受《红周刊》专访时，芒格先生说，
是什么力量使价格最终回归价值，但是格雷厄姆的回答是这样的，就是说这是我们行业的神秘之处，对于我和其他人而言一样是神奇，我们只是从经验上可以判断市场最终会价格回归于价值，就相当于它没有给这个问题提供一个答案。那么我想问一下芒格先生跟李璐先生，您二位怎么来看待这个问题，就是相当于价值投资的理论大厦现在少了一根支柱。
Well, if you keep making something more valuable, some wise person is going to notice it and start buying it. And so it's quite natural for things to be regarded as more valuable when they become more valuable. And, you know, if you want to buy a brand new automobile, say a Chevy, it costs X. And if you buy one 10 years old, it costs maybe a third of X. And everybody knows that the new Chevy is worth more than the one that's 10 years old. And so people will recognize value in time. Crazy stock traders may do crazy things on the short-term basis, but over time, value will tend to win. Suppose we'd done nothing at Berkshire but pile up money from investing in stocks. And pretty soon, let's assume we started with 100,000 and pretty soon we had 10 million. People would notice that we had 10 million and that the stock was worth more. It's natural for stocks to eventually go to value. But Ben Graham says in the short term, it's a gambling machine, the stock market. But in the long term, it's a weighing machine. In the long term, the market will figure out what's really worth it.
所以就是这个市场时间其实最主要就是时间，给了足够的时间，越来越多的人就会看到，尤其是你的价值本身越来越增加的时候，大家就会发现，这个其实也是很自然的，也没有什么mystery在里面。
我在这个问题上跟他回答一样，我没有什么不。为什么？芒格先生曾经提出哈，以合理的价格买入优秀的公司，就是强烈的影响了巴菲特先生。巴菲特就形容，就是让他实现了从一个大猩猩到人的一个转化哈，那就显然就是大猩猩不如人高级嘛。 那就是说格雷厄姆的这个烟蒂理论哈，和您主张的以合理的价格买入优秀的公司这两个的实质差别是什么？就是为什么以合理的价格买入优秀的公司这个理论就更高级？高级在什么地方？
Well, Buffett is right, and you can go directly to human being. No point in going through the chimpanzee mode. Well, the beauty of it is that it keeps working when you're not. A great company will eventually earn more and more and more while you're just sitting, doing nothing. And a mediocre company won't do that. So you're harnessing a long-range force that will help you. It's just very important. These mediocre companies that are, they by and large are going to cause a lot of agony and very modest profits. And if you do find it goes up a little, you have to sell it, you have to find another. It's a lot of work. Whereas you just buy one great company, if you get it the right thing at the right price, you just sit there.
这个区别是什么地方呢？就是这个你买完了以后，它的价值会不断的在这个提高。你什么都不需要做，只要坐在那儿等待就可以。那么那些就一般性的比较差的便宜的公司呢，这个它不会做这样，你会这个各种各样的烦恼，各种各样的问题，然后你的这个收益也会很少。 而且你一旦它稍稍涨出了一点，你还要卖掉，然后重新再找这样一个机会，你会不断的去做。这个最后的结果也不会太好。那真正伟大的公司，你找到之后，这个公司本身就会不断的，这个创造新的价值，它的累进的这个价值本身就会以累进回报的方式的不断的去增长。所以你做的唯一的事情就是耐心的坐在那等待就可以了。
就是我知道芒格先生跟巴菲特先生很厌恶杠杆哈，那么就是这个机会是100%确定的，也不用杠杆吗？
Well, when you say leverage, we use a little leverage because we got the insurance float and so on. So we have worked a little bit of leverage into our, but it's safe leverage. Nobody can call those loans or get nervous and sell our securities or something. But we use a little bit of leverage, but not much. And we don't ever borrow against our securities. We have 100%. Of course I would. If you give me 100%, you'd be out of your mind not to. You can't lose. You've by definition, of course, you'd use a lot of leverage over the cinch.
Nothing is 100%.
Yeah, that's, well, nothing is. But suppose I use this example. Suppose you have a childless rich uncle, and he has a huge enterprise. Enormously valuable, growing, getting more valuable. And he says, come into my business, I'll make you my heir, and you will inherit this wonderful big business. You've just been offered a sure thing. You know? Why would you do anything else? You'd double down on the sure thing. Of course you would. That fortune's formula that came out of those people that beat the Hong Kong racetrack out of $100,000 a week for many years. But that was their formula. You can't bet too much in the Hong Kong, or you'll change the odds. That's the way a racetrack works. But they bet more when they were sure, and less when they were less sure.
对，他说呢，就是关于这个杠杆啊，别说，其实是 Berkshire 是用一些杠杆的，因为我们的这个公司呢，主要的是用这个浮存金去投资，实际上浮存金也是某一种性质的杠杆，但是这个浮存金的这个借贷呢，和一般的借贷不太一样，因为我们没有一个固定的。 这个借款人非要到时候把我们的钱要回去，所以我们完全可以自主。所以这种情况下的这个杠杆其实是非常安全的杠杆。当你有这个100%的确定的时候，你会不会用？那当然应该用。当然世界上这个100%的事情几乎没有。所以就是这个正是因为这个原因，你才会比较小心的要用去杠杆。但是有一些时候。 也可能确实这个几乎是百分之百的可能性，所以并不是说不用杠杆，但是杠杆本身因为投资本身是没有十全十美，没有百分之百的，因为是对未来的预期，这样的例子其实很少啊，在绝大部分的情况下是没有百分之百，在这种情况下，使用杠杆就不是那么安全，所以一定要比较小心，但是在安全情况下去使用杠杆是。